together and praise the Lord, right? So today is our Back to Church Sunday, and if you are back to church and first time in a long time, well, we praise the Lord for you. You fit right in, and God has got his arms wide open for you. And if you've been here every week, well, praise the Lord, because God's got his arms wide open for you too. Amen? So we're going to read Psalm 33. If you want to look at your Bibles, you can do that. And I'd like to read just a little bit out of that. If you are a first-time visitor, first-time guest, do me a favor and fill out the connection card that's in front of you. And I'm going to do something different. In the past, I would ask people to drop it in a collection card. I'm going to do something different. I want you to bring it to me at the end of the service so I can meet you. I can talk to you a few minutes and say hello and also give you a free gift. Wow, look at that, huh? It just seems like an infomercial or something. But yeah, please do that. And I want to be able to get to know you a little bit. So members certainly want to go ahead and allow some of our guests to come and do that. So if we got a line guest, you got an automatic in the front of the line, okay? I get the front of the line pass free card there, okay? You show that little connection card and get to the front, okay? Psalm 33. Sing for joy in the Lord, O you righteous ones. Praise is becoming to the upright. Give thanks to the Lord with the lyre. Sing praises to him with a harp of 10 strings. Sing to him a new song. Play skillfully with a shout of joy. For the word of the Lord is upright, and all his work is done in faithfulness. He loves righteousness and justice. And listen to this. We just sang this. The earth is full of the loving kindness of the Lord. Amen and amen. And Father, we pray for you.
Several ladies have already started on the journey, and it's not too late for you. It starts at 6:30 and beats a warm match on either Tuesday evening or Saturday morning. Just pick what works best for you. Contact Lisa Caldwell's Warm Match by phone or text 513-315-6875 or via email at lisawarmack@gmail.com. That's our Happy Good Friends Back.
Yes, amen. Your family. Amen. Your Tebow. Yes, Jackie. So good to see you, Jackie. application. So we're going to do something, and I did something kind of super secret and somewhat not so secret. Somewhere in the pews, I want you all to do something for me. Look around on the pews, and I want you all to search for a sheep. A sheep. You've got a sheep. You've got a picture of a sheep on your pews. Go ahead, look around. Look around. When you have it, I want you guys to pick it up in the air as high as you can, because I know there's a sheep. Now, you might have to stand up, and you might have to look around. Come on, now. You all can loosen up a little bit here, okay? I need to take this jacket off. I think I'm getting this too tight here. Look around. You'll find a picture of a sheep. All right? Anybody got a sheep around here? Anybody find a sheep? No? Not yet? No! We did have a sheep, and the children took it. That is hilarious. I never would have thought that I would have been a problem. See, Paul, I should have even burned that too, bro. All right. So the lost sheep was the first parable. Well, I got your attention, right? And if we look at chapter 15, we see this lost sheep, and Jesus says, and I preached on it a few weeks ago, you can look on YouTube or look at our church website, which will link us to the messages. And it says, what man among you has 100 sheep and has lost one of them, doesn't leave the 99 in the open pasture and go after the one which is lost until he finds it? He's thrilled to have found that sheep, right? That sheep was lost maybe in ignorance, maybe not knowing that this sheep was lost, the sheep got lost. It's, sheep are stupid. Sometimes that will happen, okay? Let's look for another one. Somewhere around on your pews, you will see a lost coin. And you remember the parable of the lost coin 2 weeks ago, maybe some of you remember. And I mentioned that one of the possibilities is that this coin was a missing coin in a wedding headdress. Out of 10 coins, she's missing one. And that headband was missing a coin, and so it was very valuable, very sentimental to her. And that coin was probably lost in carelessness and looking around until she finds it. Now I got one more picture, and some of you have probably already found it. A person has probably already found it. As they were looking for the sheep, they found a picture of a man on a piece of paper. So you all look around for that picture of a man, and it's about a half a page there. You all look around. Come on now. Everybody get up and look around. There it is. Thank you. Give her a big hand. Yeah. Awesome. Awesome. Thank you. Okay. So we've got a picture of a lost man. This kind of represents the older brother. The older brother of this story that we find out that the older brother stood at home while this prodigal son went and for wine, women, and song, right? And so this older brother was self-righteous, though, is what I talked about last week. And he was lost in his own self-righteousness. Now, we come to the most famous of parables, the most famous of them, and that is the prodigal son, the lost son, the one that's easy to remember because we remember how outrageous his sins were and how outrageously sinful he was and how horrific it was what he did. And we remember because it's such a dramatic change from the worst to the first. It's an amazing thing that happens. And so let me just explain the story a little bit in Luke chapter 15, verses 11 through 24, as we heard read. Let me explain it a little bit. This younger son had wanted to gain his inheritance early, and he violated the norms of the culture at that time, and the norms of that culture said that he was to get his inheritance later, but he wanted it then. And so in that culture, they would get one-third of the inheritance would go to the younger son, and two-thirds in that case, in that setting, would go to the older son. So that younger son got one-third of the estate, and he had the nerve to ask his father for that inheritance early. Amazingly, the dad says yes, and he gives him this inheritance early, and it was shocking for me to ask for this money at the time, but he gives him the money, and lo and behold, that money is gone almost, well, maybe not almost right away, but it's gone pretty quick. This young man spent it on loose living. Did you see that in there? He said he squandered his estate with loose living on 13, which is a relief for me that I don't have to explain what that exactly means. But you get the idea. And he spent it, and he begins to starve because of famine comes, and he says to himself, he's saying, you know, I need to get back home. Well, the parable, the thing about the prodigal son that's so amazing, the thing that we love about the prodigal son is it doesn't matter how far you are, and how far off you are, and how far away you might have been from God, and how far away you might have been in life, there is always another way back, and there is the only way back, and it's Jesus Christ. God, listen, He is the God of second chances. Did you hear that? Our God, my God, is the God of second chances. You have that chance to always come back to God. And this is the beauty about the story of the prodigal son. Now, if you're following along in your notes, you look inside your bulletin, or if you have a smartphone with the Bible app open. Anybody have a Bible app open right now? All right, look at you guys. Yeah. So you can go into the notes, and you can fill that in, and you can email it to yourself, or you can do it the old school, low-tech way with a pencil and paper that will never have to reboot on you, right? Okay, so you can do that as well, and that's fine too. But you follow along in your notes, and the first thing you're going to know and see is that there are four reasons that I'm listing here that you can come home. Four reasons to come home, and four reasons you can have in your mind and in your heart that you can't come back to God or to come to God. The first reason that we find out right away is that you are never, listen church, you are never too far gone. You're never too far gone for God. This younger son has come to the worst of the worst. He has hit rock bottom. Now, I know they're all self-inflicted. I know that he has caused these problems on his own. I know he got the money. He violated the norms of his culture. Here's another thing that he did. He not only got the money, and that violated the norms. Listen to this. He got the money. And what was valuable to the Jews at that time? The land. Remember that? The land. All the promises of the land. Hello? They went with Moses out of Egypt, and they went to where? Eventually, they got to the land, the promised land, the land of promise. They wandered about for 40 years, but they finally got to the land of promise. Amen? And this is a good thing. This is a valuable thing. They split up the land among all the tribes. The tribe of Levi, they got their own thing too. But everybody else got their land, and they had their land, and that land was valuable to them, and the land was they were. It was a promise from God. This young man got the money, violated the norms of his culture, and went far away from that which was valuable to him, his land. He went as far as he can go away from the land, and he was totally turning his back on the land that was promised to him. This young man, in other words, was really rebelling against his father. Then he spent it on loose living. Don't have to explain that, do I? But the older brother did get a little more specific, and I can say what the Bible says without expanding it. He did say that the money was spent on prostitutes, wine, women, and song, basically. Here's the other thing that this young man did in worse conditions. He got money from his father, violated the norms of the culture. He went far away from the land. He spent it on wine, women, and song, right? Right? But then it got even worse. Listen to this. He got really, really hungry because it was famine out there. He lost all his money. Now listen to this. He got so hungry that he said, well, you know what? I'm going to go ahead and get myself hired out to do some kind of a job. You know, I admire him for that, right? If you don't have any food, what are you going to do? Well, you need to do what, brother? You need to work, right? Amen? If you don't have food, you need to work for your food, right? You work in some way. So he went out and he got hired on, and he went out to he's still hungry, make enough money. But what was the job that he was doing? Feeding pigs. feeding the swine. A young man who was Jewish, who was a person of the promise of the land, would never want to be able to do something that was unclean to a Jew, which was feeding the pigs, because they were an unclean animal. And it got even worse than that. Look at what he says here. Look at the chapter here. And it says here that he went in verse 15. Y'all got the Bibles open? Say, aha, aha. Okay. He went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country. He sent him to his fields to feed swine. And he would have, listen to the 16th, look at it now. He would have gladly filled his stomach with the pods that the swine were eating. And no one was giving anything to him. He wanted to eat those little locust tree pods, or carob pods, that they were feeding to the swine. He wanted to eat that. That was pig food. And this Jewish boy was wanting to not only feed those pigs, but he wanted to eat the food that the pigs were. That's how far gone he was. He was as far gone as he could be. He was in the worst conditions. And we say today, he has hit rock bottom. He is at the bottom of the bottom of the bottom. And you may be sitting here today, far from where you should be. You might have done things unspeakable, or even the worst of circumstances that you find yourself in, that have overwhelmed you like a rising flood, like this young man. But let me just tell you something. Even though you're in the worst of conditions right now, what this young man finds out is that you are never too far gone. Second, it's never, never, ever too late to come home. Look at verse 18 for me. So got your Bibles open and say, Okay. Verse 17 starts out this kind of thought. It says, when he came to his senses, duh, right? Something slapped him in the face. Your stomach growling would kind of do that a little bit. You know what I mean? He came to his senses and he said this. He said, how many of my father's hired men have more than enough bread that I'm dying here with hunger? Well, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to go and I'm going to make a speech. I'm going to go up and I'm going to say to my father, and say to him, Father, this is a speech he makes. Father, I have sinned against heaven, and in your sight I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me as one of your hired men. And you know he has been practicing this and practicing this and practicing this. And you know how I know that? Because he says the same exact speech, except a little part of it, a little later on. And he's practicing and practicing and he's practicing. So he's getting up and he goes to his father. He felt that, you know, he could be a servant of his father's, and so he could go and be hired off, and then he could eat, and he could be okay. And he doesn't have to be his son. All he has to do is be his father's servant. And so he comes home, and to everyone's surprise, his surprise, everybody's surprise, what happens? The father, his father, runs to him. And you say, well, that's not a big deal. If I had a child that's not in church and my child came in through the doors, I would run up and run to him in a heartbeat. Right? I remember a few years ago, my family and I went to Florida to see, well, we were at Disney and different places, and I think we went to the beach, actually. We went to see my father and my mother while my father was still alive, and at their place in Astor, we went to worship with them in the First Baptist Church of Astor, Florida. And so we were running late. It was a good distance of driving. We didn't have the time just right. We were getting late. And apparently, my mom told me this afterwards, is my father, who had a scooter, he sat on the scooter, and he was up towards the front. And he comes in the back door, you know, and he's sitting with a scooter. He says, come in, Jim, I'll come back, okay? I promise you, okay? All right. So he's sitting in the scooter, you know, and he's sitting there, and my mom said that he positioned his scooter, instead of that passive, just a little bit at an angle so he could turn and he could watch the door for his son and his family to come through the door. And and the music's playing, and we're still not there. The music's playing. Finally, this late guy comes in with his family, and he's thrilled to see us. And so we kind of try to sneak in. You ever do that? You get in late into a church service, or you get late somewhere? Come on now, you all have done that, right? And so you get in there, and we came in this back door over here, and asked her, and they had a main door, and so we're trying to sneak in. We're trying to sneak in. And they're waving us up! They're going, come on up here! So we're waiting, so we have to, all of our family make our way along the front, you're over there, and make our way up front, and we had, it was so embarrassing. But it was where we sat with him. My father was watching for me. This father was watching for the son. And in that culture, it's unheard of for older men to run to the boy that they are missing, to lower themselves in that way. Yet the father ran to the boy and said, forget about the culture, I love my son, I'm running to him. So we find out that this boy is seeing the dad. Apparently we figure that the father has been watching for this boy, this parable, to extend even further, day after day, waiting for the time when the son was to come home. And how many days we start thinking in that story did the father sit and watch, wondering if this could be the day that his son would return? How many times did that father look to the horizon for that boy's silhouette as he crossed the hills to the home? And when this day had come, this father came to run. It's never too late to come home. Daddy has got his arms wide open for him. This father came running for two reasons. One, the love. But the second is, think about this, and I want to read Deuteronomy 21. I want you to hear this. This is just an amazing insight that I got as I was studying this week. It says this in verse number 18, if any man has a, listen to this, a stubborn or rebellious son who will not obey his father or mother, and when they chastise him, he will not even listen to them, then his father or mother shall seize him and bring him out to the elders of the city at the gateway of his hometown, and they'll say to the elders of the city, this son of ours is stubborn and gluttonous and rebellious. He will not obey us. He's a glutton and a drunkard. Then it says in Deuteronomy 21, verse 21, that all the men of the city shall stone this boy to death. So you will remove the evil from your midst, and Israel will hear it of fear. The father running for his son showed his love for him and also protected him from possible stoning to come. What's the big deal about that? He showed grace to the boy as an example that we are to show grace to others. Jesus is speaking to the Pharisees here, the tax collectors and the scribes. Pharisees and scribes, and they have this Pharisee-like, this self-righteous attitude, and he is speaking to them that, yeah, you have every right to throw stones at this guy, but look at this example where the father gave grace when he didn't have to give grace. What was the father's response? He came to the boy, look at the text again, and this is amazing. In verse 20, while it was still a far way off, his father saw him and felt compassion for him and ran. Look what he did next. And embraced him and did what, church? He kissed him. The boy hadn't even said anything yet. And in that culture, a kiss in this manner is a way of symbolically saying, I have forgiven you. This boy hadn't said anything. And Dad has already forgiven them. It's never too late to come home. Because before the boy can even speak, he's forgiven. As this lost, sinful, shockingly selfish boy was forgiven, so are you. Come home, come home, come home to your father. Come home, turn from your wicked ways, is what he's saying. Come home and receive forgiveness for all that you've done. Come home, those unspeakable, those horrific sins that you might have done in your life. Come home, because even though no one knows about the sins except for you and God, you have a God who forgives you, a God who that if you confess your sins to, is faithful and just and will forgive your sins and cleanse you from your unrighteousness. Come home. It's never too late, church, to come home. And though you're never too far gone, and though you're never too far, never too late, know this, this is the third part. The Father will never stop loving you. He'll never stop loving you. Because here's what's amazing. This boy begins his speech. You know that practice rehearsed speech that he had? Remember this? Guys, he says, Father. Right? He's God, and here's the orator. Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. And I am no longer worthy of being called your son. And then he's supposed to say, make me one of your hired men. Before he gets to that last part, after he says, I'm no longer worthy of being called your son, his father cuts him off. And unlike the boy's prepared speech, the father has something out of his heart of love. He says, come here and give me a robe. This is a personal, expensive robe. This boy took a third of his money and his estate, and he gives him more, a personal, intimate, expensive robe that he puts on him to show him who he is. And then he gives him shoes on the boy. He says, give him some shoes. This boy has no shoes. Give him some shoes to show he's not a servant. He's my son. And then he gives him this ring. And we see an unbelievable love of this father that has never stopped loving him. It is a shocking, awe-inspiring love of this dad. And you know what's amazing to me? As shocking and awe-inspiring this love is, that is nothing compared to the love of God has for us. This man, who had every right to turn his son over to the authorities, here comes that sinning, scum son of mine, that good-for-nothing son of mine. Here he comes. Now he's hungry. Here he comes. Now he's begging for more. He could have easily turned him over to the town and taken care of him and done it. He was dead. He was dead. Did you hear what he said? Look what he says. He says this. He says later on, his brother, of course, but he says his son of mine was dead. He could have left him, and yet his father didn't stop loving him, and our father will never stop loving us. And God the Father will never stop loving you and everyone. God loves you and me well beyond whatever any of us ever said. We look at the Bible, and we can look through the Bible, we can see examples of this, and we can look in Scripture, we can see how God called a guy who had a anger problem. Okay? This guy had an anger problem. He was a murderer. This guy in the Bible had seen somebody kill one of his people, so he went to kill the guy. He took him out. Took care of him. Yeah, right. Think it's Godfather, right? Took care of him. Took him out. What did God do? God forgave him of his sin. He called him out of Egypt, and he called him to let his people go. Moses. He gave grace to a man who was humbled by him. Here's a man we talked about in Sunday school who had a lust problem. He was in the wrong place at just the time that he wanted, but God didn't want him there. He should have been off to war, but he was sticking around at the house and sticking around and walking around on the top of his roof and just kind of enjoying the night. And he looks down and he sees a woman bathing, and he says, who was that woman? They say, that's Uriah's wife. Bring her on. Commits adultery. He commits murder. What did God do? He gave him grace. He sent a man in Nathan to tell him about himself so that he can repent and he can turn. And God gave grace and forgave David. There's a man in the Bible, if you look at Scripture, that was so depressed and so frustrated, he sat down under a tree said, God, just kill him now. God didn't kill him then. God used him. He used Elijah to bring many people back to him. See, God does that. He takes the broken and he makes the broken heal. He took this loudmouth, impulsive coward, not me, but the guy who's even stupid at times, not me, Peter, who was changed by the Holy Spirit to preach the sermon of the century, and 3,000 people were killed, were saved, and had wisdom and grace throughout the rest of his life, and even in the court of the church history, was not crucified right side up, but crucified upside down, because he didn't consider to be worthy enough to be crucified like his Savior. Peter. Paul, who was a murderer. See, the Bible is full of these stories of these accounts of God taking broken people and making them whole again in him by his grace. You and me, we're broken people in a broken world trying to put the pieces back together, and yet we're trying to do it on our own, and it just doesn't work, does it? We gotta have God. We gotta come to Christ. And he can change us from the inside out. So let me ask you, what have you done? What have you done against God? David said, my sins were against you and you alone I've sinned. And we can talk about sin all day. We all have sinned, amen? Last week we had the Lord's Supper, and I turned and I said to you all, how many of you all have sinned? And I hope all of you raise your hands, The kids saw you. Amen? Amen? Praise God for that. We're all sinners. We don't celebrate that, but we're admitting that honestly and saying, yeah, we have done these terrible things. We've lied and cheated and stolen in some way. We've hated people, and that's committing murder in our hearts. We've looked at women with lust in our eyes, which is committing adultery in our hearts. We've done these things, and yet God still loves you. The Father will never stop loving you. Last, when you understand this, when you understand that you're never too far gone, and that it's never too late to come home, and the Father will never stop loving you, listen. The celebration never ends. It never ends. If you know Jesus as Lord and Savior, I'm not going to lie to you. You are not going to be perfect. You're going to mess up again. Amen, church? You're going to mess up. We're not happy about it. I'm not happy about it. God's not happy about it. But you're going to mess up. The idea, though, is that you come to Christ and you grow in Christ and you serve Christ and you share Christ and you lift up his name and glorify his name, and everything you do is for the glory of God as an act of worship. And you're going to worship something. You're going to worship being a self-made man, a woman. You're going to worship the God of money. And you say, oh, that's not a God. Well, it is. That's all you think about it is, right? You're going to worship your toys, like your boats or your campers or your whatever, right? Your cars. Your house. Some people are married to their house, right? Nick and I were traveling somewhere, and I said, man, that's a really nice house. Yeah, that's a really nice house. Oh, was it Glendale, remember? And I said, yeah, the problem with that is what? And he said, what? I said, you're married to your house, right? You're gonna worship something. And God says, don't place those things first. Yeah, take care of your house. Yes, have a car so you can get around town and do some things. But do it all for a different purpose, and that's to glorify his name. You got to worship something. Make it the worship of God himself. What we see here in this last part of this chapter, as we see, or this section of the chapter, is we see the Father putting on a robe, and putting on a ring, and putting on his sandals, and he brings a fattened calf, a calf who is a tenderized, fattened, young animal, and they kill it and they celebrate that this boy who was dead is now alive. This boy who was lost has now been found.
Amen.
And let me just tell you something. Jesus says this multiple times in this chapter. He said, there is more joy in the presence of the angel of God over one sinner who repents. He doesn't say that here. But I think it's to be seen and to be shown, to be implied, that Jesus is saying there is a celebration that's going on in heaven when one sinner says, I am lost in my sins. There is no way for me to get to heaven except through Jesus Christ, my Lord, and I have to pray and ask Him into my life. Eddie and I got a chance to go to a conference on Thursday and Friday, and we went to this conference on counseling. It's Counsel of the Word Conference. It's a great conference, wonderful conference. And while we were there, we got to meet with three young men in my life. All of them are early stages of their adulthood. One young man I'm going to do a wedding for next week that I knew when he was 13 years old, trying to avoid church worship services. We don't have any of those, do we? Another boy was a young man who was just a nice kid, you know, just didn't know about him, didn't know what he was going to do with his life. And then another kid was one of ours, who started going to Boys College. Let me tell you something. To see these young men grow, and two out of three of them have grown since they've been at Boys College and Southern Seminary, and to see them grow is an amazing thing. And not only did they grow maturity-wise and emotionally, but they grew, listen now, because they realized that the gospel had to be center in their lives, and that the heavenly things came first before the earthly things. Their lives are changing for a different purpose. It doesn't have to happen to go away to college. Oftentimes, you see kids go away to college, you see the other opposite, right? Church, it starts here. It starts with you. It starts with whether or not you know for sure that if you die today, you can go to heaven. Because if you don't know that, you can know that. The Bible says that I'm a sinner, you're a sinner, we're all sinners. We've all sinned and fall short of God's glory. And that the only way to get to heaven is Jesus Christ. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one gets to the Father except through me. In other words, when he died on the cross, he did something amazing. He did this exchange. All of your sins, listen to this, all of the sins that you have ever done in your life, all of your sins, when you come to Christ, when he died on the cross, a great exchange took place, and your sins were laid upon him. The Bible says that all we like sheep have gone astray, each one turned in his own way. But God laid on him, who's him? Jesus, the sins of us all, the iniquities of us all. So when Jesus died on the cross, he paid the penalty for your sins. It was an exchange. You say, why did he have to do that? Because that is the only way for us to get to heaven, is through the sacrifice of his son, because he was the only one righteous enough, right enough, to be able to make that and take the place of him on the cross. He never sinned. And he allowed you to come to him, God, by dying for you. And then raising you from the grave. So that all who call upon the name of the Lord, they are saved. And maybe that's you. Maybe you've been the prodigal son. Maybe you've been the self-righteous son. Maybe you've been that lost coin. You've been careless with your faith. Maybe you've been that sheep who just didn't know any better. Just kind of strayed slowly away. God is wanting you to come home. And when you come home, we are going to party. Father, I pray